Cool. So my name is Justin Walsh. I am co-organizer of this event here. Work at Rainbow Studios with a bunch of people and familiar faces in the room. And I wanted to give a basic overview of Blueprints. We're going to build a very quick, simple little game in 45 minutes if we're lucky. So we're going to collect all the things is what I'm calling it. So what I'm going to talk about over the course of this thing here is we have in Blueprints, you put nodes on the screen, you connect them together with wires, and then there's little pins that you connect things together with as well. I'm gonna go ahead and point out what those are and how those work and why they're there. I'm gonna talk about an actor blueprint versus a level blueprint, and if that means nothing to you right now, you'll know soon, but basically there's multiple ways to define a blueprint, and they have slightly different behaviors depending on where you define them. I'm gonna teach you how to remember things in your blueprint, or programmers would call this a variable, and they call it a variable too, so everyone's gonna call it a variable now. We don't have a fancy name for it. I also wanna show you how to communicate with other blueprints. This was something that when I first started, drove me absolutely insane because I had all this logic in my blueprint, and then I wanted to talk to the other thing in the level. And I finally figured out how to do it, and my way might not be the best way, but we'll at least get some blueprints talking to each other so you can have more complex interactions than just a simple, you know, unit that's sealed up. And then time permitting, some Q&A at the end. So I'm actually gonna start with a base brand new project. On 411.
Dot zero, man, it's dangerous.
I know.
Yeah, you know it.
When I was doing this at home, I lost like mouse focus to the editor like twice, just couldn't get it back.
At least if somebody didn't release it and then go on winter hold it.
Yeah.
That would have been forgivable. Everybody needs a holiday.
And there's also a really annoying I'm calling it a bug on OS X. When you bring up the right-click blueprint menu, it doesn't auto-select the text box for you to type in. So you right-click and type and look like an idiot constantly. So I want a new project based on this top-down template. Everything you see here is in Unreal Engine right now. If you download 4.11, you have the exact same thing that I have, the exact same thing I'm showing you. Epic gives you a bunch of starter games to mess around with. And I actually would recommend always doing that. If you're coming into blank and going to blueprint things, you are very ambitious, and you probably will hate life very quickly. So if you have an idea in your head, you know, like we have a flying guy here, a puzzle game sample, something to do with a ball in physics, just pick one of these that sounds maybe close to your idea. Or in my case, I just wanted this camera perspective, so that's why I picked this one. And then down here, this with starter content, I almost never check this, and I actually don't know what it gives you other than like 6 gigs of content that I never use. But if you install it, like, go nuts, pull some starter content in. And then I usually have this desktop and maximum quality all set. Cool, so I'm just gonna create that project. So yeah, I was hoping I could be all slick and be like, oh, I know everything and not have to let you guys see my little cheat sheets here, but not today. The first thing I'm actually gonna do is a little like Julia Child, Martha Stewart action. I don't want to remake my materials. There's not enough time right now to show that. So I'm just gonna copy some materials in. Nothing. There we go. All right, cool. So right now, other than that, you know, freshly baked materials that I pulled in, this is just a standalone game. If you hit this play right here, we're going to be in a game and we can run around by clicking the mouse button. And actually, I want to use my mouse, not my pad. There we go. And that's all this example gives you. You have a character that moves around when you click the mouse. There's some more like advanced things here. This green area that you see on the floor, that's a navigation mesh. You can make those yourself, kind of slightly outside of the scope of this, but a lot of the demos that you pick that have a character, they're already gonna have a navigation mesh in the world. And then you can look up tutorials on navigation meshes when you wanna make one yourself. But essentially, if you hit the P key in the editor, unless they remapped it, that'll show and hide your mesh. So on yours, when you first open it, you won't see the green thing. And you hit P, and then you can see your navigation mesh. What it does is you put a volume down, and it will look at all of the collidable things and generate an area in which the character could safely walk. And then it also does all the pathfinding and a lot of complex logic for you. That then you can just use blueprints to tell it to go walk around instead of doing all that math yourself. Yeah, and like in this case, this character movement component here, this guy that's selected, he's using the navigation mesh to know that when I click, where to go. Okay. So what I was thinking in this game is I want an object to just spawn in the world, and then I want to go and collect that object. And when I collide with that object, I want it to go away as a first start. Eventually, it'd be cool if it kept some score of some sort, added a counter. And ultimately, I would like it that after I collected it, another one appeared in the world. So that's kind of my vision for this small little game here. And I'm going to start wiring it up. And if I'm going too fast or doing something weird, just let me know. So I'm gonna start by making a new, fresh blueprint. There's one other thing I wanna point out real quick is this little drawer that's down here. It's normally like this when you first open Unreal for the first time, and sometimes people don't know that exists. If you click that tiny little button, because you'll see when you first load it, it'll look just like this with just your folder in there.
What it said, we actually can't see, I can't make out.
Show or hide the sources panel.
Okay.
So if you click that little guy, which it'll pop out your whole content folder. And for now, I'm gonna make a new folder. So what I did is I right-clicked in there and just made a new folder, and I guess it's called new folder. And then inside this right-hand side where your content is, after I selected new folder, I'm gonna right-click, and I'm gonna say blueprint class. So a blueprint is a class, it's always a class. They refer to it as a blueprint, but what that means by it being a class without getting too deep into it is that if you create a blueprint, you can make another blueprint based on that blueprint and slightly change its behaviors. It has like this inherited model. So if you make a thing that's like 80% perfect and you want a one-off of it, you can make a duplicate of it and then just add a couple extra blueprint nodes or whatever you want to do to change your thing that you made. In this case, I'm just going to add I'm going to get fancy. I don't want any of those. If you hit this all classes button, you can search for things. There's all kinds of actors that we can create. And to clarify there, an actor is a thing that can be placed in the world. Components can't be placed in the world. They have to be on actors. So anytime you want your most basic object you can place in the world, you're going to go with an actor. So we'll start there. And what I want a static mesh for this thing. So I'm going to get a static mesh actor. And we're going to create him. This is going to be called thing. So double click your thing. And there's kind of little handy tricks here that's happening too. This blue bar down here, it's really blurry and hard to see. Each asset type has a different color. And when you have a bunch of assets on the screen, blueprints are like that, this darker blue color. So you can, after using the engine for a while, you can quickly identify kind of what type the thing is that you're looking at. Or you can mouse over it and it'll tell you exactly what it is with all this detailed information just by hovering. So what I want to do right now is I want to make a thing to collect. And an actor in the world is made up of components. So in this case, when I said static mesh actor, it came with a static mesh component for free. You could have made an actor that had nothing in it, and you could have said add component and find a thing that you wanted to add. You could have used some other more complex thing that's already predefined in the engine and dropped it into the world. But in this case, I think all we need is like a box to collect. So I'm gonna roll with static mesh. And make sure I didn't do anything too crazy. So this top level guy up here that's selected, that's the actual actor. Over here on the right, this is the details panel, which we can see is highlighted by this orange box that says class defaults right there. Because as we switch through these tabs, we'll get different details. There's nothing that I wanna do to this actor on his default settings that he comes with. So I'm gonna ignore that for now. And I'm gonna click on this component, the static mesh component itself. And when I did that, we got a new panel over here on the right. And this, under this static mesh category, it's gonna let me pick a mesh. So I wanna just use something that's already in the engine, this 1M cube, because I don't wanna model a cube. Actually, I want the chamfer cube. There you go. It was already here because of the level that I picked. It came with some starter assets, right? There's cubes in the world. I'm just reusing one of the cubes that's in the world. If you were to be doing your own stuff, you would model this in your 3D program of choice, export it as an FBX, drag it in to Unreal, and you would have my awesome model, whatever, that you could use here instead. I like click this compile button nonstop when I'm doing blueprints. Anytime it comes up and says it needs to compile, I just always click it out of habit, because a lot of times when you add something or change something, the rest of the blueprint doesn't know that it changed until you hit that compile button. So I just religiously click that thing every time I see it changed. If something's wrong or your properties are out of whack or your blueprint itself has nodes that are wired wrong, it'll give you an error when you do that as well. So, a what? No. So everything that you do, you get undo until you hit save. So if you make a mistake, you can go back to your last save by undoing. But if you save and then if you make a mistake, then save, like, and you're not using some other source control or some other way of making like versions of your assets, you're kind of hosed. You just gotta remember to do it again. So I brought those materials in. So I'm still in the same spot, static mesh component. I gave that cube. I want a red material that's gray. I want a gray-red material. And I mean, that's pretty good for now. I have a thing. Let's go put it in the world just to test it. So here's my thing down here. I'm just gonna drag them, drop them in there. You can see the nav mesh knew that the character was going to hit it, so it recomputes on the fly. In this case, I actually don't want my thing in the world, though, because that's not a lot of fun if you always know where it's going to be. And I really don't know why it's not red, but oh well. So I'm actually going to delete my thing. And then I think that thing is also pretty boring after we dropped it in there. I mean, let's do that again real quick. Drop the thing in. Let's hit play. This doesn't really want me to collect. I don't want to collect it. That thing sucks. I don't like it. So I'm gonna delete it out of the world because I don't want it there. Open this back up, and just kind of want to show off some more like the component system. I want my thing to spin, and I can go in and make a blueprint that says like every tick. Make this thing spin every time there's an update call. Do some math to make this thing spin. Apparently spinning things is so popular that you can just add a rotating movement component and you're done. We got a spinning guy, and he's already over here on this panel where it says rotating component. He He's already yawing 180 degrees, I think it's per second. Don't quote me, but that's my guess. So if I now compile my thing, and all I did is say add component, rotating component, and then I drop them in the world. And then I hit this. Bomp, bomp. Nope, I failed. I think this is where.
Oh, there's an error. Toast at the bottom corner.
Yeah. Yeah, so let's try that. So I just clicked this mobility says static or movable. Hit that compile. On this play button, mine is going in a new editor window. If you click the little tick, you can do it right in the viewport if you want. There it goes. High five, bro. So now we got a thing that we want to collect. I'm going to save my thing. All right, cool. So I don't think it's very fun to have it just statically placed in the world like that. The game's gonna be real easy. So this is where I'm gonna get into actual blueprinting. So just to be clear, this thing is called a blueprint. This thing is called a blueprint in the engine. And what that affords you is the ability to add these components and do all this thing like in the editor without writing C++ code to say this actor has all of these properties and all of these components on it. You also get, I've been in the viewport mostly for now, you also get this construction script, which that's going to get, I'll get into what these things actually are here in a sec, and this event graph. And all of that's encapsulated into one thing that's called a blueprint. And then people will also say a blueprint is literally just this, too, when you're searching for this stuff on the internet, so it's slightly confusing. Or a blueprint node if they're talking about a singular one. So what I want to do is that we were just in, that was actor blueprints. And that's pretty much how you use them. Everything I'm about to show you is going to be done over on the level blueprint, which technically the level blueprint is still an actor. It's just a very special one that the world creates and gives certain properties to. And I'm going to show some of that here in this demo. So when you do that one more time, over on blueprints, you click it, open level blueprint. Your level blueprint, as soon as the map loads, he's executed. He's already in the world, technically. So anything that you put in here is tied to the level. And we didn't actually open a level, but in this top-down blueprint folder under maps, this top-down example map is our level. So anytime I edit that level blueprint, it's going to mark this top-down example map as dirty, and it's going to save all of the stuff that we do in the level blueprint inside of that map. So a downside to level blueprints is any work that you do there, you can't just move it to another map because it's stuck on that map. If you want to move it to another map, then that's where actor blueprints come in. I can have 100 maps, and this thing can exist in every map, and it's not a problem. But the reason that I want to be in this level blueprint.
Really quick, you can't call out from, I don't know, second example map. You can't call in the third person example map blueprint. I'm not quite following that.
Well, maps can load other maps. So if you make a map and it loads another map, then your blueprint will be loaded via that.
Oh, okay.
But you can't just like say, hey, level two, we use the level one's blueprint. You can, but that's through like sub-level loading and stuff like that. In this scenario, what we're doing is our game is one map, and if we were to have multiple levels, it would probably be multiple maps.
Okay.
So any logic that you put or any blueprinting nodes that you put on that level blueprint when you made a new map, it just wouldn't be available in that new map. Now I need my cheat sheet because I totally forgot what we're doing. Cool. So since you can see it right here, already done, I'll talk about it. But the idea is that that navigation mesh we were talking about, we have a function called get random point and navigation radius. Because it's on the level blueprint and the navigation mesh is in the world, this thing just works like magic. And that's where that Romero blueprint compendium like starts coming in handy, because a lot of times you have no idea like what you're looking for. And I'm gonna show you some ways that I find things when I absolutely have no idea. Like if I have an idea of like, I know I want to spawn a thing in the world. Spawn is the term they use for creating an instance of an object in the world. Then you can search for it using the blueprints. So right now in our level blueprint, we're in the event graph. And you get some free events that come with the engine that are always gonna be called. Begin play is one of them. And what I did here, if you right click, like it says right click to click create nodes, and then in the search box, begin play. And that's tiny. Can you guys see that already? It won't let me zoom more. Cool. So event begin play, after the map is loaded, it calls begin play. And what I mean by call is this thing here is an execution pin. And any wires, when you click and drag that pin, you get a wire. Anything attached to this white wire is going to run. It's going to execute. It's going to do the action, the node, whatever the node says it's going to do, it's going to do. So a lot of times when I have no idea what it is that I want to do, sometimes I will click this thing. And in this case, we wanted to spawn our actor. So I'm going to click and drag, drop it, and in here type spawn. And then I get all kinds of fun stuff from all over the place. This spawn actor from class looks about like what I want. Because if a blueprint is a class, then spawn actor by class, I can pick my blueprint in this thing. And then now we get to cool stuff. So these little colored pins that you see everywhere, the reason they're colored is each color represents a type, a discrete thing in the engine. This is pretty, this orangey one is a spawn transform. So if I drag off of this guy and let go, make transform just appeared. This checkbox that says context sensitive, as long as you have that checked, Blueprints tries to help you write code. It tries to know what you're doing. Since I dragged a transform off of that pin, then it's thinking you probably want to make a transform. And then that would give me this guy. And so in this make transform, I can edit these values. I can give it a location, a rotation, and a scale. I think we're actually just going to roll with this for step one. And there's, if you notice, there's more pins over here. That's because location has an X, a Y, and a Z component to it. It's a 3D position. And if you work backward and just drag the pin off here, if I want, I can make a vector that now consists of just numbers. X, Y, and Z are just the raw numbers. And if I wanted to, I could still go further and go backward and have some fun and just say random float. So when I build blueprints, this kind of took me a while. I usually start with the action that I want and work backward to make it work the way that I want to. Because if you try to go the other way, and say, I want a random float because I want this guy at a random position. And then from there, I want to make this transform because, all right, at that point, you don't even know that you need the transform. And then you're like, well, I need to spawn the actor now. Then you might have all these nodes that you drug out and realize that whatever you're trying to do, it doesn't accept those colors, those types. It's just not going to fly, and you wasted time. So I like to pick the actual action, and that's these blue ones. These blue ones are the actions that are going to be performed, and then work backward to actually create my game logic that I want. And then once you get all these nodes in your head, you might not do it that way anymore. You might go the other route because you know exactly what you want and you have a good library built up of knowledge. But I wanted to try this out actually. I wanted to say make a transform, leave everything at default. And then right here in this class, when you click the drop down, it's gonna give me a list of every single thing I could possibly spawn. If you type in the search field thing, our thing shows up. And this is kind of like tricky, this collision handling override. So in Unreal, when it spawns something, if it's gonna collide with something, sometimes it won't spawn it. It won't do it because it collided with something. And for gameplay, that makes a lot of sense. If you're just like spawn these things all over the place and you don't want things spawning on top of each other because it looks weird, then it just won't spawn it. But if the thing that you want to spawn absolutely has to be spawned because it's crucial to your gameplay, then you can come into this guy and you can say always spawn, ignore collisions, and no matter what, it's going to make an instance of them. You can say adjust location but always spawn, which means if it is colliding, it's going to push it out of whatever it's colliding with in some way, either up out of the ground, out of the wall. And if it can't do it because you happen to put it like in a death valley of collisions, it'll just spawn it anyway. And then there's a try to adjust location, same thing. It'll move it around. If it can't figure out a spot for it where it's not colliding, it won't spawn if that's important to you. And then I don't know why you'd ever pick do not spawn, because that's why I came here. For this guy, I'm gonna say try to adjust location, but always spawn. I'm gonna compile that. This is on my map, so you can see here, or I can barely see here. There's a little star next to this to let you know that this guy is dirty. And notice there's no save button. That's because that map that we are at is dirty and he needs to be saved. So if I save the world, it's good. That's saved. And that's part of the thing I was saying where the level blueprints actually live on the level and travel with the level. So I don't know where 00 is, but let's try this thing. I don't see my thing. It's nowhere. It's nowhere to be found. So when I can't find stuff, usually this eject button right here is really handy. And what that does, you hit that, and now I'm not attached to that player anymore, so I can just move the map around, and the game's still running right now. So that thing should be in this world somewhere if it worked. And then over here in this world outliner, everything that's currently in the game is gonna appear over here. So I'm gonna find it. I'm just gonna thing four, it actually is here. If I hit that guy, selected it, I hit F, that will focus. It pushed him under the earth, right? That's what just happened. He's actually there, but when I said if colliding, move it, it pushed it down. That's not cool. I need to collect that thing. So what I'm gonna do quickly is I'm just gonna, in Unreal Engine, the Z coordinate is the world up, going up out of the ground. I'm just gonna fudge it, put 200.
So did you have negative values in for Z?
No, it was at zero, but the plane that the guy runs on was also at zero. So it collided with it, and since I had that little drop down checked that said try to adjust location but always spawn, it pushed it down and then spawned it. So it didn't push it up because it had no idea that I wanted it to go up.
How did you know what direction you pushed it?
I have no idea.
I was just gonna ask if you can lock the axes that it's allowing.
I do not know.
Most levels actually also spawn at a higher, they spawn at a higher charge.
Oh, they do, they're lifted up.
Even landscapes do usually. So all right.
Gotcha. So yeah, that could happen too. If the plane was at 100 and it said 000, we just told it to spawn under the world and we couldn't see it. So all I did here, I put location Z300. I'm gonna try it again. There's our guy. We can't collect it right now, but it's there. So yeah, just to recap, like, That's probably one of the simplest possible things you can do in Unreal to get going with gameplay or anything, just spawn an actor. You don't have to understand what these transforms are or any of that stuff, but obviously the more you dive in and learn, the better. For artists, you should know what transforms are because you're modeling in 3D space if you're a 3D modeler. Even in 2D land, you have an X and Y axis that you're moving things around in, rotation and scale. So this big transform node is pretty self-explanatory after that. I don't want to keep spawning it in the same position though, because that's no better than just dragging it into the world. So I'm gonna get rid of that transform. And I wanna do this guy, get random point and navigation radius. So all I'm doing is clicking into an empty space because the color of these nodes are important. As I was saying, they color code everything. This red node is an event, which means someone else is going to call this event at some point in time, and then it's going to execute down the wire. If you actually pull this out so you can see the level and this at the same time, maybe. I don't know how I'm going to do this. Hold on. And you hit play. Yes, just do the thing. Oh, I didn't hook up a transform. I'm stupid. And it didn't compile. Let's put our transform back. But this is a good example of when I was saying you hit the compile button and stuff messes up. It was not happy. Are you not gonna work today, bro? You get nice cryptic error stuff, but it's kind of cool. It tells you that the pin is invalid, so it's expecting one of these to be set. You get an error on the actual node to let you know exactly where the problem is. Wire this thing back up, hit compile, it's happy. And then all I wanted to show, normally when I'm working with Unreal, I have multiple monitors. I recommend everyone do that because it's not fun on one monitor. So this red guy, he's an event. When I hit play, no, would you stay there, dude? See how it pulsed right there? That's all I was trying to show you. So whenever you're designing blueprints and you have any doubts about what's happening and you have multiple monitors, just hit the play button and everything will just pulse and it'll show you, like, it'll follow all the wires no matter how complicated and twisted they are and show you exactly what just happened at any given time. And you can even do things like pull this guy up on your second screen because maybe you have a mouse click that is the event you're waiting for, and hit play, and every time you click, it'll pulse, letting you know, like, this event just happened. And then you can kind of track down what's going on. All right, transform. Yeah. So I just know this thing exists at get random point in navigable radius. Since we have a nav mesh, this is just going to return a random point. On the left-hand side are always your inputs, and on the right-hand side are always your outputs or whatever gonna happen. So this thing here, it expects a number radius. I'm just gonna fudge something and say 400. Ignore nav data and filter class unless you know what they do. I don't. Origin, I'm gonna pull off, say, make vector. This is that kind of working backward logic I was talking about. Spawn it 000. So we're gonna have something in the middle of the world, 400 units wide, and this return value.
You want 00300 or something, right?
No, because what's gonna happen is it's just getting a volume to test against. Uh-huh. And then when it actually returns, it's gonna give me the point that's on that navigation mesh, that green thing. So return value here, pull it off. Backward, make transform. We'll put his location into that. Looks like he's right there. Let's try again. This guy's cool. I thought I said 400. Maybe that's really tiny in this world. So when in doubt, add more zeros. Okay, now I can't find it. That's good. It's a game. Thing 11. Where is he? It won't focus him. That's not supposed to happen. It's supposed to give me a point, like, actually on that mesh. So, life's not perfect.
Did you point it to the nav data? Those pins are pointing.
No, it usually just shows up. Let's go look at my cheat sheet. All right. So I did it slightly different in my cheat sheet. Maybe that's the problem. Another thing that you can do, instead of dragging off of these pins, you can right click a pin and say split struck pin. Now I have X, Y, and Z all right here in line. I think that looks a little cleaner.
So that works with any strut?
Yeah, if you just, like, any a vector is technically a structure, so
yeah.
you can usually just say break pin, rotation, I can split it. And scale, I can split it. So instead of making more nodes, you could just have a billion going down. If this doesn't work, I'm gonna Martha Stewart again and jump to the completed project. I don't know where my thing is. It shouldn't spawn it outside of the nav mesh. Nope, they always have been empty. Collectible thing.
But it looked good when we had the smaller radius.
Yeah.
What's that?
It was on the map mesh.
Where is he now? Oh, I know why. You have to build.
Oh.
You have to build your geometry to calculate the actual nav mesh. So here's that build. We're just gonna build. And I don't care about that. Oh, but I got lighting. I didn't want lighting. We'll be here for a while. Alright. There he is. Live stuff takes way longer than you'd think. So, since we're running out of time and all the projects are online, I want to look at my notes real quick. And can you guys see this as well as the other stuff? Pretty much?
As well.
Yep. So, this is what I did here. I ended up doing a random point in a bounding box instead of in a radius eventually when I was building this. There isn't too much difference other than the world was square, so why not put a square object around it?
Can you open with preview and zoom?
Do what?
Open with preview and then zoom.
So this is the same logic for spawning active random location within a bounding box. This didn't even use the nav mesh, this just went inside a bounding box. That was awesome. And then there's the navigable radius thing that we were working on. Man, I failed to teach you guys everything.
A lot of times learning how to fix stuff when it's broken is the best way.
Yeah.
Almost more important than being able to just do it.
Yeah, so when Martha Stewart bakes things, magic happens. So we're gonna go that route.
So yeah, I just looked at the code. If you don't pass the nav data,
So,
throw an error on the
with my
yeah, it's just surprising.
Super ambitious presentation, this is what we were gonna end up with. But here's the part where I am spawning the actor. I wanna talk about some more of these nodes so at least you can walk away with some good stuff here. There's the sequence node. So on begin play, when you pull this guy off, he can only connect to one other thing. You can't pull multiples off and keep reconnecting it. So they created this sequence node. When you drag off, you can just, there, I got bit by that thing again. You can say type sequence, and it's under this flow control. That creates a sequence. And all that is going to do is just like that. Begin play is gonna come, sequence happens. The first guy is gonna go off and do his thing. Then the second guy is gonna go off and do his thing. I wanted to show you actually collecting the thing. So in here, this is where we get to talk about like communication and events and stuff like that. On this begin play, there's this bind event to on actor hit. And there's a couple ways you can get that are more intelligent than the way I probably did it. If you're doing it on the blueprint yourself, when you select a mesh and you scroll down in this panel, these are all events over here on the right. So if you knew you had a thing and it wanted to be collected, and you're like, okay, well, when this thing is hit, hit that plus button, it'll put an event right in your blueprint, and then now you can wire a node off and go and continue building your logic. And events are kind of just slightly different than anything else we've seen. They have these red square boxes. So most of the time, we'd right-click to create something or drag off to create something. With the event, you can do the same thing. When you bind to an event, this is the weirdest thing, because an event is an input, not an output. So you drag off an event, and then under here you can say add event, add custom event, and give it a name. And that's exactly what I did to get that there. And then what's gonna happen is anytime an action in the game happens, the event that's plugged into it is going to fire its execution node off of this guy. So what I did here is, it tells you whenever something gets hit, you get to know like the actor that initiated the hit with self actor, the other actor that you hit, and you also get some physics data if you want to go do things to make it move around in the world. What I did here is I said other actor, and you drag this off, get class, and this is more of blueprint as a class. Every class has a type. There's only one collectible thing in the world, and it's my collectible thing blueprint. And what I wanted to do is say, I needed a way to say, how do I know that when I hit something, it's my collectible thing? So I pull off this branch node is an if statement if you're a programmer. If not, when the flow happens, whatever is plugged into this condition pin right here is gonna be a yes or a no, a true or a false. If it's true, it's gonna only fire the event down this wire. If it's false, it's only gonna fire the event down that wire. Both can never happen at the same time. It's one or the other. So in this case, I said, make sure that my collectible thing that I hit, so pull this off, get class, pull this off, equals equals. And I believe that's what I did because the word compare didn't work for me. Just type equals equals in there. It says that, or you can type equal. Lets you do a comparison. Comparisons always return a true or a false. And when it is the thing that I hit, I want to call destroy actor on it. And I just took the other actor, the thing that we hit, and piped him into this destroy actor. And then here's another fun, super hyper advanced event, event dispatcher. But regardless, when I hit it, he dies. So let's double check that. That was not my thing, the green one. There he is. And then when I grab him, that fired the on hit event that was back, looked like it was backward in the way you set him up. And I actually keep spawning him every time you hit him. And the game's over when the game quits. So you have no choice. You are done.
He's ready for early access.
Yeah. So the thing that I really wanted to show was some more of the variable stuff, because I think I have enough time to do that. We're almost out. I'll go over this real quick. Over here on the left-hand side, you can create variables. And variables are just ways for you to store data. If I say plus variable here, it's gonna give me a thing. I don't know what I want to store here. Like was thing hit. Over here on the right-hand side, every variable has a type. If you click this drop-down, you know, Boolean is like a gating logic, true or false, is the only thing you can store in there. Integer, float, both numbers, subtle differences between them. If you need a decimal, use a float. If you don't care about decimals, use an integer. Name, string, and text are all ways to store words in Unreal Engine. That could be its own whole discussion. Just quickly, if you're gonna localize things, pick text. If you don't care about localizing, pick string or name. And then look it up for what it actually means, like in the documentation. Vector, rotator, transform, all things for manipulating actors. So what I wanted to do here, and you can see it through here, is on event tick, I can set this time elapsed. And the way I did that is I hit the plus button, made a time elapsed, came here, set it to float. And then the fun part is I was telling you about hitting compile all the time. When you first make a variable, it actually tells you, please compile the blueprint. I can't set a value on it until I hit this button. Now I can say, yes, that thing was hit. And that'll be its default value. And default value means when I drag this in here, I can either get or set. If I say get, this will always give me the value of that variable, however it's stored. So in this case, was thing hit, check to true. If I pull this off and put it into here, this is always gonna be true. It's always gonna follow that top wire. Alternatively, if there's an action and you wanna set that thing, same thing, I drag it off and hit set. So what I did here is I made a time elapsed value, and every tick, I set my time elapsed by taking the current time elapsed. So this was why it was fun, which, you know, drag, get, time elapsed, drag, set, time elapsed, pull pin off, add delta seconds to time elapsed, take that return value, set it back into time elapsed. So now every time the game ticks, whatever's coming out of delta seconds, which should be the amount of time that has passed since the last time it was called, will be accumulated into this variable. And then what I wanted to do is I was made a time allowed variable, and I set 20 seconds because it's in seconds, the time that's coming out. And I compared it, which if you do programming comparison operators, I think is how you have to do it, because I don't think greater will work.
What, are you trying to compare floats?
Yeah.
You have to do nearly equals.
No, this is okay, because as long as it's greater.
Oh.
If it ever passes my value, I want it to be true. So time keeps adding up. Once the time value is over 20 seconds, then it's true. But when you're looking for like comparisons, you have greater than, less than, equal, all of that. You can use the shortcut ones, which are like the programmer scripting ones of the carrots and the equals, or you can actually just type greater, and it'll show you that greater than equal to. You can type less and get the less than stuff. And then the result of that comes in a branch, and then I quit the game. So just one more time, I'm taking the current time elapsed, which when this level starts, its value is 0. Adding it to the delta seconds that come out of here, which are currently 0 because the game's not running. Setting the time elapsed again, which means the value of time elapsed is now the old value of time elapsed plus delta seconds. And then at any point in time, whenever this time elapsed value is greater than 20, it's gonna be true or false with a comparison. So once this value is greater than 20, it will tell me true. Every time it's less than 20, it will tell me false. And so I could do something like this if I wanted to. Print string, still playing game. Just to let you know, go find those things. So that's the compare. If the compare fails, it went down the path of still playing game to the screen. When 20 seconds is down, it's going to make a noise and kick me back to the editor. If you're opening a window, it would close it down. Not a super useful node. unless you're making a menu and you want to quit the game. I also wanted to show some of this real quick. That's advanced stuff. But I wanted to show that using the event mechanism, I had a way to bind to an event, and this is an event dispatcher. You can go into the project, or you can hit me on Slack, and I can explain it to you more, or you can talk to me after, because I'm going to end this presentation pretty soon. Whenever that event happens of you collected the thing, which was in another blueprint, I was wanted to fire this off to go back up to the code I already wrote and spawn another thing, and then come down over here, and the same thing with more variables. I wanted to create a collected things variable, which I decided should be an integer, because I can't collect like a half a thing. And then this node here is a fun one. It's just called increment. So that will just add one to the current value, but it doesn't save it. So if I just stopped here and I didn't store it back in collected things, then every time this ran, it would be zero. This thing would be one and it would print one, but next time it came through, it'd still be zero. So that's why I set it to collected things. And then this is kind of a shortcut. Whenever you set the variable on the right-hand side, it just gets the value that you just set. It just kind of passes it through. And then I print it to the screen.
Are you certain? Isn't that increment first point that reference point? Didn't you set them this
screen? I was pretty sure you had to get the value out of it.
That first pin right there, is it a diamond or a circle?
Well, never mind. It does say it sets it. So I'm wrong. You don't have to do that. Thanks again. So that's it. And I did want one more thing. Always one more thing. Hey, that whole project's on GitHub. The GitHub link is on the Unreal Phoenix website. So you don't have to remember that link. You can just click the GitHub, and it'll say collect all the things. When you're on GitHub, you can download a zip, so you don't have to download any special software or anything. You can just say download zip, pull that on your computer, double click the project. As long as you have Unreal 4.11 installed, you can go explore everything that's there, and hopefully use that as a base and do other weird stuff, like add more scoring, add HUD elements. It'd be a good spot to start exploring further with some basic logic in there. And sorry I took so long to get through that. But if you have any questions, go ahead and shoot, and then we'll be done.
I have two. Where do you guys keep utility functions? Like, do you know? I don't know where you would store those. For instance, you will have like some common vector manipulation you constantly do. You don't want to keep that in one simple in one blueprint class or anything. You want to keep that as like, I don't know, some utility function somewhere.
Yeah, you can do a couple things. Under this right-click menu in the content, you can go to Blueprints, and there is a Blueprint Function Library.
Oh.
If you click that thing, name, and you come in here, this is dealing with more the advanced stuff of Blueprints, where you can create functions inside of Blueprints to call later. Call me now. So I have this function here. And when I click this, print string, hello, hit compile, save that. So now let's say in my character, I put all my complex logic into that blueprint function library, saved it on tick. If I just type his name, he appears. So now you can have all shared things and reusable things happening in that one spot,
yeah.
And any blueprint can call that function.
Do any of those work across classes as well?
Blueprint function library is available everywhere. It's in your level blueprint. It's in
okay.
Every class. It's the entire game. You can get to those functions that you define.
And then the second question was earlier when we were having trouble finding like the box and those kinds of things. What kind of debugging tools does Unreal give as far as, you know, you were able to do things like print statements to the console and stuff, so you can check execution.
Yeah.
What other kind of debugging?
So print statements are good, but they're only going to get you so far.
Yeah.
You can actually just click on a node, right click it, and say add breakpoint.
Oh, sweet.
And then when you compile this, this is begin play, so it should begin hit very quickly. It stops, shows you that the execution's happening, and it's waiting on this event right here. At this point, I don't have any values to inspect, but if you hover over pins that are active,
you'd be able to see the value.
It would start showing you, there it goes. So there's target is self, and his current value is, I don't know if that's a zero or open close braces. And then when you're here, if you want to follow the execution, you have resume, frame skip, stop, and step. If you hit step, then it's going to go to the next thing. And that next thing might be an entirely different actor, an entirely different blueprint, which is what just happened here. And if I keep hitting step, now I can go back and investigate these values. X equals, this is probably really small, but just hover over the pin and you can see that there's the X, Y, and Z value of that vector. So if it looked weird to you, you would know, oh, that's way off, my math's wrong. And that's the only thing I can inspect in this current step. Yeah, it's just going to keep going through there. And then when you're done, hit resume and you're right back into the game. The other thing I wanted to call out is this question mark guy. He is there because if you click him, there's an open help URL. This is in the project when you download it. That's going to take you to the YouTube Introduction to Blueprints video tutorial series. And there's like 9 or 10 tutorials. And that guy goes into depth with everything you could possibly want to know with getting this game going further.
Cool.
Thanks, guys.
Cool.